Good evening.
Good evening.
I think Peter fed me too much. I have a hard time to even breathe. Food was so good. I just can't. Some of my friends says Geshe lad wolfs down, so I just wolf down your delicious food. So now I am kind of facing the consequences, having difficulty to breathe. And because at some point I was actually, yeah, as a monastic, as a bhikkhu, you're not supposed to eat after lunch, but then you also have the excuse, health excuse of diabetes being, everybody said you have to have something every few hours. So,
a little bit every
few hours. Yeah, that's true, but, it's not, I don't know, it's not, maybe it's not my fault, it's the food fault. food are so good, so it's their fault, I have another Dharma friend in Spokane, and he's such a good cook, and he cooks for me, So same thing, it's again always food fault, Always fault is always someone else's, not us. So, well, thank you so much. It's been sometimes since we met last, and and these two short and most profound teachings of Tsong Khapa. One about the Guru Yoga, and the other one is what we call three principal aspects of the path. It's also, both are actually, it is in short form of gradual path, the Lama, just putting it into different ways. Maybe it's important to kind of introduce, I don't know if everybody does, is that as you read the phrases, you may, if you are a good observer, you will see this is basically designed. But lots of Gelugpa lineage teachings and practices are designed for the monastics. For the monastics, or like heading towards the monastic life. So lots of the advices and guidance are designed for monastics. So you will, as we read, we will see this. And also the reason Tsong Khapa came out and laid down this lineage was because it was a very needed in Tibetan Buddhist tradition. Monastic, tradition was somehow kind of a little chaos over the centuries. So Tsong Khapa's actually coming up and laying down the entire system of path is to refine the precious Buddhist tradition. not only Buddhist tradition, as we say, is that Buddhist tradition in a sense, like we say, Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. Sangha, which in the conventional level, Sangha is the monastics. So monastics are the one who preserve, practice, and prevail the Dhamma over 2,500 years. And this is the reason that why we have, unlike any other religion, why we have three germs, Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha. The way we respect Sangha is because the Sangha community, the monastic community, is the center. They are the one who practice, preserve, prevail the Dhamma, make Dhamma available. Right? Until now. But then, along the road, the journey of Dhamma for centuries, you have different practices, and then you have all kind of situations come and go. So it was important that the monastic tradition is, you know, refined and preserved. So the kind of, and then also the way of study of Dhamma. Tsongkhapa's way is like deep study, years of studying and debating, and like, you know, 18 to 20 years. In Tibet, even sometimes 25 years, you spent in studying the Dhamma. You know, really, it's not studying the Dhamma as a part of doing sadhanas or rituals, but the deep studying, philosophical, just digging into the philosophical depth. So that was the tradition in India from the 5th century, 6th century, 7th century, when Nalanda was up. Nalanda University, you know, when it was up, like, so then, yeah, as we see now, when you go to India, go to the pilgrimage, you only see the ruins. But when it is amazing to see the ruins, how it was at some point, right? Then amazingly, all of this, like, over 100 volumes of Buddha's teachings, we have in Tibetan from Sanskrit version. Each of these scriptures, when you read, at the end, Tibetan way of, ancient way of writings, at the end you see the translations and how these scriptures are refined over and over and over to the authentication. And most of you read, those pundits who did those works were from Kashmir, actually. You know, a lot of them in from Kashmir. And then, it's amazingly, modern times in Tibetan language, we say Khache. Khache, we refer to the Islam or Muslim. We say Khache, Khache, Khache. I have not done a lot of research, but I think it is kind of a wrong connotation. Khachi basically means the saffron, the herb saffron flower in ancient.
Saffron.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in Asia those days, in that subcontinent, the Kashmir area is the only place where saffron was found and grown. So the people are named after the production of the land. So Khache. And so now, because it's all dominated by Muslims, now you kind of refer it to the religion, but origin, I think, is something different. So because all these Buddhist scriptures that we read, at the end, in Khache Pandit so-and-so, Khache Pandit so-and-so, lots of them are Khache, now as we refer as a Muslim, you don't believe that a Muslim would do the Buddhist scriptures translation. and then, Pandit, as we say, the term Pandit also, in some ways, in one aspect, Pandit meaning a scholar, in certain level of scholar, but there's also a way of calling Pandit is that race of people is called Pandits. If you go to northern area like Himachal and this area, you will meet people like totally 100% illiterate people who would even not read a single alphabet, but their race, their blood, lineage is Pandits, so they are called Pandits. You so many Pandits out there. So there, human history is interesting, way things develops and changes. This is kind of something that just came to my head. I think we will first start with the. I want to maybe we do together, okay? Not just one first and the other one. We do together, so that way. So we will look into the foundation of all good qualities. Now. Within the different Buddhist schools, we have we humans, right? We humans. There are different thoughts and sayings. Tibetan Buddhism, or the Tantrayana is not Buddhism. They have taken it from Hinduism, there are those kind of things people say. It's not something happening now. It has been long, those thoughts. And there are some kind of different disputes of thoughts between the Theravada and the Mahayana tradition, that's kind of like here and there. But overall, in Mahayana tradition, particularly in Tibetan Buddhist tradition, we take the Guru Yoga, the devotion to Guru, respect to Guru, the gratitude to Guru, it is very seriously. And it's not kind of a religious belief, or yes, there are great many scholars in India has written many scriptures talking about how important Guru is and why you see Guru as Buddha and so forth, but it using quotes is one way of teaching. You can do that within the, I sometimes say, born Buddhist. Within the, like Tibet or Thailand or whatever, in the full, Buddhist society, Buddhist community from the centuries. So that when that is the case, then you don't really require to study. You were just born there, you believe you're Buddhist, right? I can recall myself when I was a kid. You just follow the culture, go to temple with your parents and that, know nothing, zero here, know nothing. But you just follow the tradition, bow everywhere everybody else bows, and say everybody what everybody else says. right? And you believe I'm a Buddhist, but so therefore, in Tibetan Buddhist tradition, we take the Guru Yoga, the respect, the devotion, the gratitude to Guru is number one. We say that is the root of all the realization, all the benefits that you gain in the path, which depend on how you treat your Guru. Because the Guru is the source of all the knowledge, all the wisdom, all the realizations. Because there, you can actually logically, with if you really think deeper, you can prove that. Because just like thinking for ourselves, we are here. Yeah, we are fortunate. We have gotten human, precious human life, and so forth. But we are here in the 21st century. Buddha came to the world 2,500 years ago. We were not fortunate enough to see Buddha, hear from him, and get enlightened. We have got human life this time over after 2,500 years. Buddha. When we say Buddha, we are kind of referring to the historic Buddha Shakyamuni, the Gautama, the Buddha. But there are infinite Buddhas, right? Buddhas came, gone, bodhisattvas came, gone. Deities, various deities, according to the tantric teachings, various deities, come and go. But we are not fortunate enough to actually to go see them or learn and hear from them and get ourselves enlightened. So for us, our gurus are the one who actually passes the profound, the message, the teaching of Buddhas. Our guru are the ones that we learn from. Whatever Buddha has taught over 2,500 years ago. So even from that point of view, yes, Buddhas, there's nothing like Buddha. Yeah, you can talk a million things about Buddha. But for you as a person, without my guru, I have no idea. I didn't even hear the word Buddha. To be able to hear the word Buddha, I depend on my guru. My guru introduced me to the Buddha and Buddha's teaching. Right? So therefore, for somebody who is in the path of Buddhist practice, in the path towards awakening, path towards enlightenment, path towards Buddhahood, there's nobody like your guru, your spiritual master. They are your guide. Right? So, so with that stated, normally in Buddhist tradition in general, I believe, but particularly in Tibetan Buddhism, yes, as a human being, two things are so important. One, of course, our parents. The mother gave you the birth and raised you, right? Together with the father, the parents. They are the reason you are here, you got human life, whatever, whoever you are today, they are the reason, the mother, of course, number one. And then secondly, as you grow up, your master, your guru, is the one who show you the right path towards Buddhahood. Right? Correct you when you're wrong. Teach you when you are ignorant. So, therefore, the parents and the guru are the most important, most valuable in a human being's life. So, now here, as we go through, understanding the fortunate life is found once. Here, once meaning basically saying rarely. We are not ruling out this is only one. Like, yeah, other religion, there are, life is just once and then either go to heaven or hell, right? Like just, but here in Buddhism we understand the journey of reincarnation, infinite reincarnation. Like we say, like talking about life, you know. The Buddhism that I know, we say, you know, there's no way to point out a beginning time of our life. So we basically say from the beginningless time. From the beginningless time, but there is an end. That end is when you achieve the Buddhahood. Or in other words, if you follow through the Theravada tradition, when you achieve the nirvana, that is the end, that you're no longer thrown out into the cycle of death and birth. You know, when you achieve nirvana, then, right, you are out of the samsara. That's where you got the liberation from the samsara, right? So there is an end, but there is no way to point out a time, a point that I begin my life cycle. There's no beginning, there's no way to point out a beginning. So there we say, that's where we begin. So now, understanding the fortunate life is found once, which means rarely, there is greatly potential and difficult to find again. Bless me to cultivate in unceasing motivation to make the most meaningful every day and night. So now, the first line in Tibetan saying, our gurus are the root of source of all the good qualities, right? Good, basically good quality. Yeah, all good quality, but basically learning on wisdom and compassion. Two key things in Buddhist path: wisdom and compassion. So, guru is the source of all the good qualities. Tsūshin tenpa lamdi tsāwaro. Now. Relying on guru, guru's teachings, guru's guidance, properly, tsūshin, properly, exactly as you are guided. Tsūshin tenpa, lamdi tsāwaro, tōne, lekwa tōne kuwa, so realizing that is the only way to do, kuwa chenpyo tenpa chinchilo. So therefore, with the greatest respect and devotion, rely. Tenpa meaning basically rely. Like we say normally, Buddham Saranam Gacchami. Right? Buddham Sharanam, taking refuge. Sharan, taking refuge, taking protection, seeking protection from Buddha, right? Sharanam, gacchami, I'm going to, right? Buddham, sharanam, gacchami. I'm going to take refuge in Buddha, right? So, same thing we are saying, when you do this, if you're taking refuge in Buddha, then you do it with the fullest respect, devotion, wholeheartedly, reliance, right? No, like, uncertainty or cynicism or whatever, right? So that's the way you follow your path. So the kind of a basic idea of how important, what it means, your gurus in your life, in your path, for somebody who is in the path of Dhamma, in the path towards Buddhahood, towards Nirvana. Now, Lenchik Nyebe Tewe Tesangde Shindu Nyege Tunjin She Chur Ne Nyinzen Kundi Nyingbo Lembe Lo Junjin Meba Cheba Chinjin Lo. Now, realizing that since this precious human life, I don't know, some people may even not recognize when we say how precious this human life. I don't know if some people may, I hear some people, oh, I don't know, kind of, you know. I would like to be a bird, or they fly beautifully. But yeah, when we look into the, what we say in Buddhism, Buddhist language, sentient being, and all different kinds of species that exist, we only know so much. But in comparison, the fewest is humans. We only kind of estimate about 7 billion humans if you compare to other types of species, animals, birds, insects. Then you know how rare is human life. That's one way of seeing it. The other way of seeing it is like, other animals have other qualities. Some animals have like a special quality of sense. Some animals have a special quality of eyesight. But overall, if you look into the physical body, the way we are built, the things we, our human body can do, and most importantly, the brain, the human brain, what human brain can learn, you know, what human brain is capable to do is amazing, as we know. The way we can, you know, think, learn, and innovate. So therefore, that's one of way of saying how precious human life is in comparison with other species. Then from Buddhist point of view, having met Dhamma, not just being born as a human being, but within the human realm, having met the Dhamma is the rarest of the rare, rare of the rarest. No, I'm saying rarest of the rare, right? Mm-hmm. You have to correct me. Right? Did I say okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because it's not about attachment. It's not about attachment because the Buddhist teaching is not based on a mere belief system. It is so much like we all can understand is based on the logic and reason, law of causality, right? These law of causality and law of interdependence, that dependent origination that we in Buddhist philosophers have been studying and talking for thousands of years, now modern science have kind of found, you know, a little bit here and there. Even just watching, putting the TV on, TV anchors are talking about karma. TV anchors are sometimes talk about interdependence. I don't know if they really know what it is, interdependence, the depth of the of interdependence. But you do hear, that kind of makes you feel good, you know. Yeah, they have at least some sense out there. You know, the idea is that it is about the law of causality. It's about how things dependent to one another, right? So based off of the logic and reason, the path, then introducing your own potential, like who you are, what potential actually you do carry. You know, you can achieve this, you can achieve that, you can actually do this, and you can reach there. Right? This is what Buddha introduced us. Like, you know, like if we kind of simply say as a lay language, it's like, you know, I was like you, I was one of you, with my effort, with my practice, I got this transformation, I got this realization. And you can do that. We all have the same potential. The term we use is the Buddha nature, our innate quality, our innate quality, the compassionate nature. We all carry the same thing that what Prince Siddhartha had. Prince Siddhartha's Buddha nature, the innate quality of, you know, the compassionate nature, and our compassionate nature have no difference. You know, it's so clear if you sit quietly when take some time and just really reflect within. Your true nature has no evil. Your true nature has no anger. Your true nature has no jealous. Your true nature has none of those negativity. Your true nature is pure, compassionate. Yes, when we run into a situation, then emotions arises. But when you really sit down and look within your true nature, what we normally call Buddha nature, has no evil, no negativity, by in its nature. Right, so that's what we call Buddha nature. Life is as impermanent as water bubble. Remember how quickly it decays and death comes. The consequences of the positive and negative karma follows after the death, just like a shadow follows the body. You also have the other translation, but yeah, translations are tricky. I've seen some of the like black and white karma. The people translated it very literal from Tibetan, you know, very literal. And in Tibetan expression, kabo meaning, white meaning, virtuous, napo meaning, negative, non-virtuous. So when you literally translate into English, black and white karma, I don't know how much sense that makes in English readers. Those who actually are familiar in Buddhist languages, then they understand. But so basically what we are trying to say here is the consequences of the positive and negative karma follows after the death, just like a shadow follows the body. Do you have any questions so far? No question? Good, okay. Luzo yuwa chi yuchu wuxi nyudu jibwe chewa chenpani chewe jesu lebe chame, kanna lende chi shenpa wala. Kanna lende chi shenpa wala, kanna lende chi shenpa wala. Finding the firm, definite conviction in this, may I abandon even the slightest negativities and accomplish all the virtuous deeds, bless me to be always careful. So, so now, according to the Lamrim Chimo, these three verses that we're reading is what we call small scope path. Basically, good thing is that achieving at least some level of renunciation toward the pain and suffering of the samsara. And the first thing, when you achieve some kind of basic pain and suffering, and like, oh, this is too much, you know, pain and suffering and all this, and then that's where you go to the Buddha Dhamma Sangha, the refuge. That is the first step of the path, right? And then, as you go on the path, then you not only take refuge to Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, like, but then you actually walk the path and seek the liberation from the samsara. Right? Liberation from the samsara. In Theravada language, you can say seeking the nirvana. Right? In Sanskrit tradition, you kind of talk about Buddhahood, fully enlightened state. So, and then the only way you can do is actually looking into the law of causality, how karma follows. When you talk about karma, like an advanced Buddhist may have better idea, but some people, those who are kind of new, may not have deep enough idea about karma, because Those are not easy to understand. Yeah, in the gross level, easy. Right? When you see your neighbor dying, you see impermanence. When you see tree falling, you see impermanence. But if you try to, you know, look into the subtle level, the moment by moment changing nature and the impermanent nature, moment to moment, is hard to understand and realize that clearly. You know, so therefore, then karma again. Some people think karma meaning kind of one thing, kind of one thing that kind of following from the past. But even if you think past following your karma, following you from the past lives, how many past lives? Infinite. What types of past lives? Infinite. From human to the animal to the insects, we have no idea what kind of lives we have taken. So thinking of karmas that they have collected in each time of their different lives. So karma is infinite. Even thinking of this lifetime, from the childhood up to now, like thinking of myself, I'm 60 now, right? You kind of, at a gross level, you think, oh, you know, I've been good, you kind of say, oh, I've tried my best, and kind of, yeah, you really don't know. Seriously thinking, you know, what have become, every moment you like, of thinking, talking, acting, every thought, every action, every word you say, every emotion you experience has karma, has consequences. Oftentimes you don't even realize that you are literally lying. You know, if you really sit down and meditate within, you have no idea how many times you have lied in a day. For reason, no reason. Sometimes for a reason. Maybe sometimes, rarely a good lie for a good purpose. But oftentimes, just simply keep lying to protect your face. To pretend how wonderful I am, how good I am, how learned I am, how wonderful I am. Just to show off, to protect your ego, you keep lying. That's what we do, you know? But so really, if you think deeper, every thought, every word, every action you do has consequences. That's what we talk about karma. And then, so we normally say, oh, I've done my best, I've done nothing wrong, kind of feel good. Are you sure? Kind of, you know. If there's a machine that screens every thought and every act you do from morning to evening, you got to read it evening, okay, what I have done today. You know? We humans are tricky. Obviously, we don't really do like really, really ugly things, but not always like, you know, like little humans are messy. So that's why Dhamma is so important, moment to moment, whenever you have time, try to think and try to reflect in, and that helps, you know, just keeping an eye on, as we say, helps. So then, yeah, life is like a bubble, as we say here. It's so true, so true. Like I have a plane ticket to go back to Spokane, right? Tomorrow. So basically, I'm planning my sense of ego, my sense of permanence is actually planning, thinking that I'm there tomorrow to go home. Who knows? When you look into seriously, that is the case, but we keep planning. I do plan to go home. I do carry a ticket. But you never know if I'm going to use it. So, trying to look into the true nature of the life, the nature of impermanence, momentary impermanence. It's a very powerful, but it takes some deeper contemplative meditation, the concentrative meditation, to get some stronger realization of the very subtle nature of impermanence. And then, samsaric pleasures are not only unreliable and never satisfying, but they are the door to all the sufferings. Realizing these shortcomings, may I develop a strong determination to achieve the bliss of liberation. Please bless me. Now, led by this pure conviction, with mindfulness, alertness, and great caution arise, may I keep pratimoksha vows, the root of the teachings, as the heart of my practice. Please bless me. Okay, I'm in a way kind of a little curious. How do you find this translation so far? Any English translation?
Yes, it is a little bit different than the other one.
Yeah.
I'm not too good to say what it really is.
Yeah. It
sounds very similar to the one I've read, but I always enjoy when you make a slightly different word, because then it kicks you out of that habit thought of just reciting by rote, and then you have to think about it again.
What is the meaning? That is, I think, is helpful,
Mm-hmm.
It is so important. One of the human problems is that we don't think. We like to follow. We like to believe. When people say exciting stories or someone, we kind of like to follow and get excited, right? So thinking is important. Samsaric pleasures are not only unreliable and never satisfying, but they are the door to all the sufferings. Realizing these shortcomings, may I develop strong determination to achieve the bliss of liberation. Please bless me. Okay, so if you kind of go line by line, samsaric pleasures are not only unreliable and never satisfying, but they are the door to all the sufferings. Any question in there? I think that's an easy way because we have only so much time, right? Is there any question in there? Samsaric pleasures are not only unreliable and never satisfying, but they are the door to all the suffering.
Question would not be, what is it to be without of samsara?
What's that?
So my question would not be, what would it be without that samsara, all those samsara pleasures? How would life be then? How come? How to fill in your life then?
How would life be without samsaric pleasure, right?
Yeah. Not to make that cause, but that's what we constantly do.
That's true. Yeah.
But then, of course, the other side is, imagine how it would be without the suffering.
Yeah. So, okay, the simple answer would be, how would it be without samsaric pleasure? The life without samsaric pleasure. How would a life without samsaric pleasure, right?
Yes.
Peter's question. That would be like Buddha Shakyamuni.
Mm-hmm.
That would be like Buddha Shakyamuni's life.
Mm-hmm.
that's what we're looking for. No? It's amazing. But you see, it's always so important to kind of really look into context, you know? When you talk about the suffering of the life, then yes, that's that particular time that you're focusing on the suffering, the nature of suffering, how and in the gross level, the subtle level, and so did da 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 da. But that doesn't mean that you kind of look into life 27 kind of like negative way. There are, like, when you talk about Buddha nature, then it's all bright. Buddha nature, you know, the possibility, the quality that you carry, what you can actually achieve. You can actually become a Buddha. So there's, you know, in the different context you look into your potentials as a human being, as a sentient being, your compassionate nature, all just wonderful. But then it's also important to balance, to look into the other side, the darker side, then the samsaric problems.
Mm-hmm.
In basically in Buddhist teachings, like when we talk about Four Noble Truths, basically the deeper thing you talk about, the desire attachment, the greed being the main cause of all the problem. But then that greed, where does that greed comes from? It's the ignorance. The fundamental cause of all the problem, just go to the fundamental ignorance, right? So then looking into the everything, like it is strange, like myself, for example, there has been time when I was a child, growing up in the refugee settlement. I remember one time I was washing my clothes in a little river, and I found there are patches and stitches on my pants, 13 in my little pant that I was wearing. You know, my mother's, every time there is a hole, my stitches or put a patch on, I found 13 stitches and patches in my little pant. Those days, you know, I've done everything. We have been like breaking rocks to make gravels, you know. Your whole family, day and night, doing this, making gravels. And then the contractor would come and measure, and you know, how much you have done, and they give you some pennies. I started to work and earn some money for my family at age 11. Like doing dishes, you know, washing clothes, or taking care of the house and all of this at someone's. And I used to get 6 rupees a month. 6 rupees a month. And that 6 rupees was a good help for my family. Because we can, all we had is what you grow. And there are lots of human needs that you don't grow. And we don't have money. So every penny is important. We have no money. So when I started to work for my family at the age 11, doing dishes and you get 6 rupees a month, and 6 rupees is a lot of money then. You know, and then I remember those days. I used to, beg around on the streets. Used to eat from the trashes. I've done all those things. You know, looking into the samsaric suffering. There has been that time. But then, as a Tibetan, we always, you know, it's just the grace of His Holiness, the Dalai Lama. Situation improved. We built monasteries, you know, out of nowhere. The monastery, now we have over 5,000 to 6,000 monks, like Sarah Monastery. When we built in the early 70s, we started with the 300 monks who came from Tibet, and we were the first a batch who joined the monastery. And so coming through all those experiences, somehow, I don't know. And then, when I became a monk, I was going to go to military, but then I, receiving some teachings of the Dhamma, I changed my mind, I became a monk. I took everything very seriously. I wouldn't say I got a perfect renunciation, but I was never attracted with the human materialistic luxury. Never, never. You know, simplicity. It was quite, and is quite, satisfying to me. You know, I think that itself is a little bit of peace. You want more, you don't get, then, you know, I think it's a suffering. So, led by this pure conviction, with mindfulness, alertness, and great caution arise, may I keep pratimoksha vow, the root of the teaching, as the heart of my practice, please bless. So now, oftentimes, people, I don't know how, people would like, okay, Theravada tradition, Mahayana tradition, Tibetan, da-da-da-da-da. But there's no, in reality, there's no Buddhism without Four Noble Truths. You know? If you believe and accept you are Buddhist, your entire path and practice is based on the Four Noble Truths. So you are not something different than what you call Theravada. That is starting from studying from the First Noble Truth, Second Noble Truth, Third Noble Truth, Four Noble Truth. It's all based on the Theravada path. So you are not different than the Theravada itself. And particularly when it comes to the Vinaya, the monastic way of living. The entire monastic way of living, monasticism, is Theravada. You know, it's called pratimoksha. In other words, it's individual liberation. Right? Individual liberation, pratimoksha, it is to seek liberation from the cycle of death and birth. Right? From the karmic force. So therefore, whether it's a Tibetan Buddhism, whether it's a Chinese Buddhism, whatever it is, if you are a monastic, the path you are following, the vows you have taken is Theravada tradition. You know? But today, those who kind of a connotation there, oh, that's the Theravada tradition, or that, da 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 da, they kind of differentiate in reality. Like a person like me, for example, I have my Theravada practice, which is my monastic life, right? And then from the Sanskrit tradition, from the Nalanda tradition, starting from the Heart Sutra, you talk about Bodhicitta, right? So entire path, the altruistic path, the Mahayana path, you know, that what we normally call is the Sanskrit tradition, Nalanda tradition. And then Tibetan Buddhism is famous of being like Tantric Buddhism sometimes. You know, we have Anu Yoga, Ati Yoga, all kind of yogas, right? So then basically saying, okay, so we have the monastic practice, Theravada tradition, and then you move on to the Mahayana tradition, like the path of emptiness and bodhicitta. And then you move on based off of the path of emptiness and bodhicitta, you enter into the Didi Yoga, the highest form of Buddhism. That's where you actually a lot of the practice and path is through the visionary practices, right? Like we normally say, practice of different deities, generating oneself in the deities. Right? There's a lot of work. So therefore, therefore, not only bodhicitta is important, but to be able to really do a pure, a real, a genuine tantric practice, you have to have some level of understanding of the emptiness. Without that, the tantric practice may be not that meaningful. Of course, with good intent, you know, with good intent, saying wonderful sadhanas, saying wonderful mantras, always good, virtuous act, no question. But with a genuine good realization of bodhicitta and emptiness, and then practice tantric path, it becomes true, meaningful, powerful, and true realization. So therefore, we say in like three levels. Vinaya practice, the monastic way of living, the foundation. And then, like Buddha Shakyamuni, Prince Siddhartha became a Buddha at the age 35. After 49 days, he started his first sermon. That's where he talked about, right, begin from Four Noble Truths. After 10 years, he started the teaching of emptiness, the Heart Sutras, like popularly known as Heart Sutra, at the Vulture's Peak in Rajgir, after 10 years, right? That's where the Mahayana teaching started. So therefore, there's a reason why it took 10 years for Buddha Shakyamuni introducing Mahayana tradition, the idea of emptiness, the idea of bodhicitta, you know, concerning compassion to all sentient beings. It took 10 years from the day when he did his first sermon. So, but somehow in Tibetan tradition, we kind of jump on everything right away. People just go, oh, there's initiation, oh, go, 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 go. Or there is a, transmission, oh, go, go, go. Don't really, you know, care so much to learn, and that has been a tradition in our culture for a long time. Yes, again, there's a saying, yeah, of course, it is a, if you say, it is a, if it is a good karma, bad karma, yes, good karma, of course, right? Good intention, going to teachings, whether you understand or not understand, you are actually going to Dhamma teaching. That going to Dhamma teaching, investing your time and energy to Dhamma teaching itself is a wonderful thing, good karma. But if you do the things the right way, then you actually make it much more meaningful than just kind of doing a good karma thing. Right? So it is so important that we follow the path, like gradual path, you know, build the foundation first. So then here we talk about the renunciation. It may be not realistic, like renouncing everything overnight, changing overnight doesn't happen, but gradually, you know, learning and trying to put into practice, which will keep you in balance from not going too much of, you know, like too much attachment, not going into too much of greed, not going too much of those all those crazy things. So learning and trying to put into practice will keep you in balance. And that itself is a wonderful, right? And, yeah. Our time is running out. So, just as myself fallen into the ocean of samsara, seeing all mother beings in the same situation, may I take the responsibility to free them by practicing the supreme bodhicitta. Please bless me. So here now, we are kind of stepping onto the next phase, like I just said. After 10 years of turning of the Dhamma wheel in Saranath, Four Noble Truth, after 10 years, Buddha was once again back to the Rajgir, and they went to the Vulture's Peak with the Avalokiteshvara, Shariputra, and many more bodhisattvas, and great amount of bhikkhus and bhikkhunis and so forth of that time. That's where Buddha started to approve the dialogue between Shariputra and Avalokiteshvara about the emptiness. So that's why if you really look into the Heart Sutra, there's only a few lines at the end is the word from Buddha, but entire Heart Sutra we change now today is basically mostly the conversation between Avalokiteshvara and Shariputra. But because they were, the conversation dialogue was very meaningful, exactly the Buddhas would see the way, you know. So Buddha has, with smile, Buddha approved the conversation. So we call it is Heart Sutra, it is Buddha's teaching, because Buddha has approved it, right? So we are stepping into that path now, Mahayana tradition, so to say, or the tradition of Nalanda, the Sanskrit tradition. Just as myself fallen into the ocean of samsara, seeing all mother beings in the same situation, may I take the responsibility to free them by practicing supreme bodhicitta. Please bless me. Now these things are actually so profound, like talking about the emptiness and bodhicitta are the key, they are the profound thing, and everybody talk about, and everybody, including myself, I guess, we all not only talk, we try to practice this, we try to meditate on that. And then, from the intellectual perspective, we kind of understand the teachings as well. But in the path, when it comes to the transformation, like making a mileage in your path, it's a little challenging, right? And we need to why. We need to know why. Recently, a friend came to me in Spokane, and he introduced me himself, and they say, "I've been meditating for 50 years," he said, "and I have written so much book, da 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 da." I said, "Oh, wonderful, wonderful." And so we just sat down and talked. And so, but then just talking a few minutes, you can kind of figure out. And he's the depth of knowledge or realization. But he did tell me that I have been meditating for 50 years. So, and then meditating for 50 years and then still kind of you don't see a lot of change in transformation in there, because our ego is not even kind of touched. Ego just never touched, remained untouched, you know? So therefore, we are actually not connecting. The object and subject remain separate. What we are reading, what we are learning, what we are hearing stays out there as an intellectual information. It doesn't touch in our heart. And instead, we kind of keep using those little learning into opposite way as a tool to make judgments. Oh, da 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 da. Instead of healing yourself, you use it opposite, outside. You know, you learn something here, but from here, you learn here, you learn here. So you feel like you know everything, and then you use this instead of using it in ripening your heart, you use it outside. You become more judgmental. It's a challenging for us practitioners. You know, it's so important that time to time just reflect within and be your own teacher. Be your own master, a tough master. Today, all times, like in our monastery, it doesn't have to be your teacher. A senior can like punish you, beat you, do anything if you are not good. Like as a novice, as a junior monk, if I'm sitting here, a senior sitting next to me, if he didn't like some of my behavior here, he would right away hit on you or whatever, you know? That and that is the way it is. Nobody say he abused me. You know? I remember myself even in the some maybe 20s, like early 20s, maybe I was 22, 23, something like that, I got beaten by my teacher one day. You know? Because I didn't follow his instructions. You know? So all I did is cried. Today, because it's everything is so kind of I don't know how to use this. So careful, so gentle. Of course, if you hit someone, that then you are in trouble, right? But even if you raise your voice, maybe not appropriate today's time. So therefore, it is difficult somebody else correct you, because this time, in this culture, nobody would try to correct you because it won't work. So then, basically, you're your way. There's no correction. So therefore, you need to be your own master. You have to be your own teacher. You have to carry a mirror within yourself, because our ego doesn't allow somebody else correct us, not even from your parents, not even from your teachers. So then there's no correction. If no correction, it is so difficult to learn and grow. You keep repeating mistakes. Right? So therefore, it's so important, try to be your own teacher. Discipliner. So now we will look into the three principles. Same thing. Okay. Lama Namba Chatsula. I bow down to the exalted Lamas. Gurus, enthusiasm to write. Jabe sunra kunji nyingbe ten jese tamba nam jing ngabe lam. Kende tanda nam ji jung ode jida nu shinta ki shevara cha. The essence of all the teachings of the victorious, the path praised by offspring of the victorious, great bodhisattvas, the gateway of the fortunate ones desiring liberation. I will explain as well as I am able. Persuading to listen. Kanda sebe de la maja shin ten jo tun yu cha chi tsun ba yi. Jawa ji be nam la yi tun be ke den te da tan yu yi ji nyu. Listen with a clear, enthusiastic mind. You fortunate ones, who are not attached to the pleasure of samsara, strive to make the leisure and endowment meaningful. Endowments meaningful. Who entrust themselves to the path pleasing the victorious ones. The purpose of generating renunciation. Namdang Yinju Mever Sizu Yi Dende Tuny Shibet Tamela Sila Kamba Yi Dendu Jenam Kune Ching Chir Tomang Yinju Zes. The same thing. So in these three principal aspects of the path, so first principle is to be able to get away from samsara. The only way you can do is to seeking liberation. And you will only seek the liberation when you have developed a renunciation to the samsara. Otherwise, when you have so much attachment to the samsara, you actually kind of are unable to understand the suffering and causes of suffering. You're literally kind of attracted to the samsara and suffering, like those of those people who suffer from drugs and alcohols and all those sufferings, right? These people are not able to see that this is killing me, this drug is killing me, this is horrible, this is bad. They are not able to see that. They just kind of enjoy it. Like, kind of saying, like, life is good. You know, like using drugs and alcohols and all ugly things, when you feel like life is good. When you're in that situation, then there's no way to get away from here, right? Because you will not seek a liberation from that situation or get away from that situation because you are attached to it, you are enjoying it in a way. You are unable to see the problem, the negativity, the suffering that these drugs are causing. Same thing with the samsaric pleasures. When so long as you are attracted to it, you are attached to it, you're enjoying the samsaric pleasures, there's no way you can seek a liberation from that because you're attached to it. So therefore, understanding, therefore Buddha introduced the suffering, truth of the suffering first, and then address the causes of the suffering, that is the reason. So therefore, until and unless you achieve some kind of renunciation from samsaric problem, then you don't seek a liberation from the samsaric problems, which means you're just stuck into the cycle of death and birth into different types of lives with the force of karmic consequences, right? Sometimes, I mean, even times people I hear in the West, you know, lots of people can kind of talk about who I am, the purpose, you know, why I am, kind of, and people talk about, like, almost like you purposely come, like, I choose to be here. I hear this kind of expression in the West a lot, you know. I choose to be here. I choose to be a man. I choose to be a woman. I choose to be a so-and-so. I'm like, really? How did you choose? Okay. How did you choose? You know, in Buddhism we are trying to understand that we have no choice. We are thrown into different types of lives out of the force of the karmas that we have committed. You know, we were just born like a piece of flesh that is actually breathing. You have no idea where you come from, you know, what brought in you, why you choose, so is you, as your mother, so is your father, why, how, no idea. You're just thrown into that situation, if it is good or is it bad or whatever it is. You're just thrown from the four karmic force, right? So, understanding that law of karma, and then the experience that we go through in this, what we call samsara, in the cycle of death and birth, you actually do want to get out of that forceful cycle of death and birth in the samsara, which means in the path when you practice, as you make some mileage in the spiritual path, like you say, grow and achieve some realization, at some point you get the liberation from that karmic force, and you become freedom from, like what you said, liberation, nirvana. So then you do get to choose what you want. Like we say, those realized beings, bodhisattvas, they are not thrown into the samsara like we are. They actually choose. They choose their lives and in the benefit of sentient beings. So that's a kind of realization we want. And that realization doesn't just come. It takes practice. Right? The purpose of generating renunciation. Beings are fully tied in samsara by the craving of worldly pleasures. Therefore, without a pure renunciation, there is no way to achieve a cessation. Chasing samsaric pleasure, therefore, seek a pure renunciation. Generating renunciation, tenjo nyega tsela long me ba yila kombe tsendi nashi do, lende minu kowe dunge nang yayang sam na chibe nashi do. Life is short and leisure and endowments are difficult to find. Keeping this in heart, attraction to the appearance of this life is reversed. By repeated contemplation of the miseries of samsara and unbetraying truth of causality, the attraction to the future lives will be reversed. The definition of achieving renunciation. Tethara kombe kowe punzo la yime keji tsangya mi je shing nin zeng kutu taba tunye lo chuna teze ngi chun cheba la. So now, here in this teaching, Tsong Khapa actually give us a practice how to achieve renunciation, and then it also teach us that how do you actually know that you have achieved the realization, the definition of now, realization of renunciation is given here. So now, so this is the kind of a mirror of realization of renunciation. Expertizing these practices one is no more attracted to the samsaric pleasures, even for a second, and desire of liberation is arising day and night, then the conviction of renunciation has been generated. Now it is for us to look in that, if we are there. And this is the first step, right? Renunciation. And then bodhicitta. Bodhicitta a little too far yet. We are still stuck in the renunciation. The purpose of generating the body mind now. Ngenjung tyan nam da semje ji simba mena lame chanju ji kunzu dewe dewe mendo londe na chanju simje ji. The renunciation also, if not possessed by a pure and fully developed heart, it does not qualify for a complete cause for the unsurpassed Buddhahood. Therefore, the wise ones generate supreme body mind. Now, these are like, in one way, I may even say like, yeah, these are like really, like, you know, common practice, you know, common practice in Nalanda tradition, in Mahayana tradition. Every practice you do, like prayers we did earlier, same practice, you know, like taking refuge and generating bodhicitta for the sake of all mother beings, you know, actually the goal is to achieve Buddhahood, those are all things, but, and that's all what we do, like, that's all we do. All the time, and yet, our attitude, our nature, kind of more or less remain as ever. We are not going more tolerant. We are not going more compassionate. We are not going more generous. We are not going more forgiving. We are not going more patient. We are, you know? So those are the challenges. We are intolerant as ever. Our ego remains as ever. That's why, like I said earlier, if someone else tells you you're a liar, I think you will go upside down, right? Right? If someone else put a finger at you and say you're a liar, you will like, what, you know? You just kind of, I think you change all your color and like even blood pressure and so forth. But if you're really honest looking, I think you keep lying all the time. That's what we do. Because of our ego. Everything you say, everything kind of you like you do is try to show off how wonderful you are, how good I am, how, you know, how nice I am, how kind I am, how you try to show this all the time. And then try to protect yourself, protect your face. You know, even though everything is like miserable in your life, you show it all, it's all wonderful kind of, right? That's what we do. That's all we do. It's honestly, you know? There's so much going on, and I'm like angry, like in the family. For example, you know, da 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 da. But if somebody is in at the door, knock knock knock, hi, try to protect your face. You know, that's just one symbol, and that's what we do, is with our ego. Instead of trying to repair it or try to work on our problems, we try to protect, hide our problem. We keep trying, keep hiding our problems, and try to show off all is good. And those are like, when I say we keep lying, I'm not necessarily saying like premeditated big lie you go do, you know. But it just, that has become a part of our life because of ego. This ego. The concern of reputation, what people might see, what people might think, you know, how may I look, I may not look, it's all about protecting the ego, which is the number one enemy to our path, the ego, but we are busy protecting that ego.
I wonder, I would like to stay here all night and
listen
to you, Geshe-la.
Yes.
We're supposed to be out of here in about 20 minutes. I wonder if you want to take some questions.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. Okay. So we are kind of, we distrust the Mahayana path in both texts, and tomorrow we will nicely move over. But yeah, question is so important, please. Question. Yeah. Question.
I have a question. So I have a daughter who's 13. She's not here tonight. And,
yeah.
You know, I'm always trying to think of how we can, as Buddhist practitioners, or trying to be Buddhist practitioners, how we can carry on this lineage in America and pass it on to younger people. And, you know, most of us here are over 50 or maybe over 60.
This is over 60.
Yeah. You know, and, so it's sort of a general question, you know, what you see from your side, you know, what some of the challenges and opportunities are for Buddhism to take root in the minds of the next generation.
You know, last night I saw His Holiness on the Facebook. His Holiness, he like tirelessly traveled all over the place, even age 80. And then purpose of all this, you know, travel, this taking this hardship is the same concern you just brought up. That is the concern, you know? Not only as just a Buddhism or Buddhist thing, but a larger humanity, you know? Just because the world's attention is materialism. All it care about is materialism. In the race of materialism, you actually lose not only Buddhism or Buddhist thing, you know, it's just basic humanistic values, the human values. You know? I can see this clearly.
Yeah.
I can see this clearly. Instead of, like, I'm going to repeat this, what we were just saying earlier, you know, instead of trying to work on the problem, people try to hide the problem. You know? In Dhamma teachings, we talk about how ego is bad, how ego, you know, is the main enemy, and all these things. But in practical, minute-to-minute living, that's all we do. We try to protect, we try to hide that ego problem, right? And if that is the case for us as a Buddhist, then that is quite common problem in general to all of us, to all humanity. And particularly in the 21st century, all attention is about material, economic, all of this. So, and then, again, the idea of individualism. In some ways, I'm trying to kind of a bridge between the Vinaya tradition. You know, the Vinaya monastic way of life, that you say, okay, in a pratimoksha, individual liberation, path of individual liberation. Now, there are some similarities between individualism. The goal is different, but the fundamental idea is individualism. So with that individualism, the idea of individualism, me, the sense of competition, you know, within siblings, between spouses. And this individualism sense of competition does not leave anybody alone. It just poisons everything. Me, one more. So in that race, what we are missing actually is we miss humanistic values, the moral ethics, you know? And then we look, okay, then and now, 40 years back, 50 years back, that time culture, today, you know, the degeneration, as we say, that we are witnessing, if you imagine, okay, now, this is what happened then and now. Now, if you think another 50 years,
yeah,
where is this world, this human society going? You know? At some point, I see we are developing a culture that humans expect one another as robots.
Yeah.
You know? They're just literally becoming robots themselves. They expect you to behave like robots. There's no human feelings. Human feelings and human values. Huh?
They make you weak.
Yeah, doesn't really evaluate. Yeah, so challenges are there. And that's where His Holiness really tirelessly, when he traveled around the world, he's not talking about the big, big thing. Only, yeah, Kala Chakra is a very popular in Tibetan Buddhist culture that when the request comes, he does. But other than that, he don't do the big, big titles, you know, empowerment. And there are so many in our culture. But His Holiness just want to see common people and talk into common language, address common issues, you know. He worked hard, and same concern, the same concern you just brought up. So to me, only way, to my understanding now, I'm just learning still, you know. It's been 5 years living here in America. I'm still really, honestly speaking, struggling with the intercultural, you know, exchange. You know, they are like, oftentimes like, we do certain things in our cultures, okay, but not okay here, kind of, you know. But he, like you say, as a parent, it's so important to talk about those things, you know, kind of make it familiar, make it some kind of a culture into their heads, you know. So as they grow up, they keep thinking about, oh, my mother used to say this, my father used to say this. We often discuss those things, you know. We often used to discuss those things, yeah. And as they grow, they learn. Because they are facing, they are living in the same samsara here, right?
Yeah.
And they, as they walk the life, they run into challenges. Then they remember, oh, my father talked about this all the time. Oh, my mother used to say this. You know? Right now, maybe sometimes you may find she's not interested or right?
Yeah.
It happens, but you have to find a mood. You have to find a good time to, you know, always try to bring those values. It will stick in their heads.
Planting seeds.
Yeah, planting seeds. And when they walk in their life, they will value you. They will think of you, talk of, oh, my father used to this, my father said this.
Yeah.